Nau mai, haere mai, haere mai e te whānau, tēnā koutou katoa, a kia noho, te ariki kia koutou. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God our Father, the friendship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Please be seated. I'm Michael McCabe, the parish priest of Te Whaia Tapu, or Kapiti, Our Lady of Kapiti. We take our name from the famous statue on the hill, and we pray the blessing of Mary to the family and loved ones of Sandra Mary Dalziel, as we knew her and loved her as Sandy. To the family, to Natalie and Neil, to Peter and Larissa, Brooklyn and Bodie, I think, are exploring the landscape at the moment, to Mark, to John, Kathy, members of the Clark family and Dalziel families, our love to you. We also speak a special word of love and consolation to Sandy's sister Caroline in Auckland, who cannot be with us today but is watching, like so many other friends, on live stream. We remember her late sister Loma. In keeping with Sandy's wishes, our Requiem Mass is very simple and we hope very beautiful. She chose all the music, and these were her favourite CD collection when she went over to Featherston to look after Brookie, as she called her, and Bodie, her much loved grandsons. So let us begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Kia inoi tato, let us pray. Loving God, to whom mercy and forgiveness belong, hear our prayers on behalf of your servant, our sister and friend Sandy. You have called her home from this world, and because she put her hope and trust and faith in you, command now that she be carried safely home to heaven and come to enjoy her eternal reward through Christ our Lord. And Mark will now pay tribute on behalf of the family. Thank you, Mark.
Thank you, Michael. Did anyone else get dressed and find they had cat and hair all over their clothing this morning?
We've had a cat or a dog in the house for years. I'm just going to run through with some anecdotes of Sandy and myself and her early childhood, or what I remember of it, and their life together. I'll try not to blubber too much. Bear in mind that I cried all the way through The Lion King. Where does one start? Sandra Mary Clark, as she was when I first met her, was the youngest of three girls to Annie Ray and Jack Clark. Jack was a butcher for Gear Meat. I think he served in about every shop they had in the Hutt Valley. And her mother sewed professionally. She had one of these fancy commercial sewing machines, and she had that in the lounge. And that's how they got by over the years. Sandy went to, I think she went to St Mary's. Is that St Mary's in the Hutt? Anyone know? Sacred Heart, that's right. At about 15 she left school and she got an apprenticeship with a couple in Broadway shops in Upper Hutt. And that's when she started a hairdressing career. And we were introduced by very close family friends of ours, the Hills. He was in the army with my father. So we were introduced, I think we were about 17 and a half, 18 years of age then, and started going out. Sandy was a marching girl, and her father was the instructor, and I was forced to go along to marching girls every weekend. Big powerful girls they were. It was murder. Carolyn was her sister was a top marcher for a top team, but Sandy was the sort of the B graders, sorry Shona. And but we had a lot of laughs and a lot of fun going to these things on the weekends. Sandy came along to some of my rugby matches. I was playing for the police cadets then with Bob and Kerry. And one particular day, it was at up at Memorial Park, and we'd gone down and she bought the car down, I think, parked it up there, and I played a magnificent game as usual. Bob couldn't pass to his right normally, so I got very few opportunities. Anyway, I scored a magnificent try, unlike Cullen. And I looked up and there was Sandy sitting in the car facing the other way. So after the game, I said, oh, did you see my try? Wasn't that magnificent? She said, oh, God, you were great. I said, you lying bitch. I said, you sat there watching Hutt Old Boys play for Tony. Oh, were you in the blue? I said, yeah. Oh, okay. Never mind, I'm good over that. Now, I'm going to chop and change a bit because memories come to me. We got married in Upper Hutt. In fact, all the Bob and Kerry were my best men, and Sue was in the party, and Carolyn, of course, was there too, so that was the whole lot. The only one missing, she's not missing, she's here, was Sandy. She loved to golf. That's a bloody story and a half. I was playing quite a bit of golf. She decided she'd like to take it up. So we went off one day to Timaru. And I don't know how bloody long it took to play four or five holes. It was eternity. And I teed off on about the 12th hole, and she duffed and scuffed and topped and carried all the way down till we got to my ball. I played a magnificent second shot and holed out. And I turned to her, I said, I just had a two. She said, oh, have you? And she said, why am I topping it? I said, I just had an eagle. She said, it meant nothing to her. Anyway, we carried on, and around about the 15th or 16th, she hit the bloody ball into the long grass. We searched and searched for this damn thing. There was no one else around, and the grass was very long. And 9 months later, we had Natalie. So it wasn't quite such a bad game of golf that day after all. Going back to her, marching days, she decided she wanted to play the cornet. She was an accomplished pianist, and she decided to play the cornet. And I don't remember how, but she hooked up with the Upper Hutt Brass Band, which, to be kind, they were like Dad's army, but with drums and trumpets. And anyway, time passed, and her father, who was the instructor for the girls' marching teams, he came along, and so they marched like Brown's cows. It was embarrassing. So he knocked them into shape, and they were actually quite good in the end. They could, you know, keep in time and march, and I think they won a few events, a wee bit for their music, mostly for their march pasts. And we went to Aussie, and they competed in the B grade there, and it was so funny to see these silly old buggers with their limps and hobbling and carrying on, marching with their chests out, and Sandy was the drum major in a little wee short skirt, marching in front of them, and they were a tremendous success over there. I think they won the B grade for Australia, or where it was, Sydney. So it was really great. It was great memories and a lot of fun. I'd just like to say I had very little to do with the organising of this funeral. Pete, Larissa, Kathy, John, they were doing all that work. I was just the eye candy, really. So my thanks to them especially for, you know, everything they did. Pete's been tremendous. He got back from Oz not so long ago, and he's been up and down from Tauranga virtually every week doing his thing, and very proud of him. Natalie, of course, she's got, there's no good nodding your head. She's had a difficult situation with her. You know, she's over in Featherston with two young kids, so it hasn't been that easy for her to be involved, but she's done her best. And special thanks to Neil, her, as she refers to him, my ex. Well, you're not ex with me, Neil, you're all right. He's been tremendous because he would bring the kids over on a Sunday when he had the kids and take them to Sandy's. Yeah, and he just went above and beyond. Excuse me. Appreciate it. yeah, keep it together, Marky. Sandy worked really hard when she got out of apprenticeship. She got her own cell in Upper Hutt, and at one stage we had four cellons, three in the valley and one in Wellington, but they were a nightmare. If you've ever worked with hairdressers and gay hairdressers, they would just drive you insane. So we felt we whittled down to none eventually. I was a little bit naughty in my earlier days, and to cut a long story short, we'll cover that at my funeral. We came over to Paraparan, and Sandy started hairdressing again from home, and she had two or three different houses, and did hairdressing from there. Hence, quite a few faces here, and I guess there's a lot online who recall. I think it's 32 years or something like that we've been in Paraparan, or why can I? So, yeah, she's had a great time over here. I must tell you a little bit about her mother, who was wonderful. We got on great, and she on this particular occasion, I was at Sandy's early on in our relationship, and the phone goes, and Ray answers it. Ray always grabbed the cigarettes and leant over on the TV, you see, and we were all in the lounge watching. And she's yakking away to this person, and then you're sitting there thinking, who the hell is it? And we're going through all the names, and we couldn't figure out who the hell it was. And she talked, and it was like Ray could talk with a mouthful of marbles underwater, so you know, you can measure what it's like. And she gets off the phone after it must have been half an hour, and I said, oh, who was that? Wrong number. Unbelievable. And talking about another thing on Sandy's golf, she was a shocker. God bless her. She tried and tried, but she just didn't have it. But she played at Waikanae, and there's the qualified handicappers, so those who've got a qualified handicap, and then there's the great unwashed who will either never get a handicap or still always struggle. Anyway, we were part at that stage, and I used to call around quite regularly, and she was wonderful. Like, she never said, don't come in or anything, you know, we got on well. She said, great excitement, she'd got a handicap. She was a qualified 36, and it was a big day. And she said, oh, I played with this lady. She said, oh, God, could she hit the ball? She was fantastic. And I'm thinking, oh, she must be a single figures or something like that. And I said, oh, what's her hand? I can't remember the woman's name. I said, oh, what handicap was she on? 35. So in latter years, I hooked up with Keitha and made her life great again. And John got with Sandy, and they got on great. But all the time that we'd separated, and it's 25 or 26 years we've been apart now, we've always genuinely remained friends, you know. We had our ups and downs and our moments, but generally we remained good friends. And it's a great credit to her that, you know, she brought up the kids. I wasn't the greatest of husband or father, but she just did a marvellous job. And it's an amazing credit to her. Let me just have a little glance on here to see if I've forgotten anyone I should mention. I'll think of a million things once I sit down. No, I think that's about all. I want to thank you all very much for coming. She would have been thrilled to see you all here. As most of you know, she hairdressed for nearly 50 years. So that's quite a career. She was a good person, a very good person. Thank you very much.
He just said to me that it's my turn to convert them all to Catholicism. Can't even say the word. But no, Sandy would do the converting.
She's got them here, you
know. She's a good lady. She's one of our saints. So let's look at the photo tribute now before we listen to the readings that she chose.
Goodbye, Norma Jean. Though I never knew you at all, you had the grace to hold yourself with those around you before. Crawl out of the woodwork. And they whispered into your brain, they set you on the treadmill, and they made you change your name. And it seems to me you lived your life like a candle in the wind, never knowing who to cling to when the rain set in. And I seems to me you lived your life like a candle in the wind, never knowing who to cling to when the rain set in. And I would have liked to love you, but I was just a kid. The candle burned out long before the legend ever did. Second row, you see, you were something more than sexy. candle burned out long before legend ever grew.
Champagne per brindare un incontro con te che già eri d'un altro. Ricordi, c'era stato un invito, stasera si va tutti a casa mia. Così cominciava la festa e già ti girava la testa. Per me non contavano gli altri, seguivo con lo sguardo solo te. Se vuoi t'accompagno, se vuoi la scusa più banale è rimanere soli io e te. E poi gettare via perché amarti come sei la prima volta, l'ultima. Champagne per un dolce segreto, per noi un amore proibito. Ormai resta solo un bicchiere ed un ricordo da gettare via. Lo so, mi guardate, lo so, vi sembra una pazzia brindare solo senza compagnia. Io devo festeggiare la fine d'un amore. Cameriere,
very beautiful what we can do with technology and what we can do. As Andrea Bocelli was singing about what we can do in our homes and what we can do with the memory of love. This was also her home, and Sandy would be brought to church, would come with Trish Kelly, would be down over the back there. So let's now listen to the reading that she chose before we pray the gospel. So Trish, thank you.
Thank you, Father. Sandy was my hairdresser, and I was a very satisfied client, and then we became friends. I feel very privileged to have this chance to read this short poem, and I hope I can do it the honour it deserves. The name of the poem, The Life That I Have, by Leo Marx. The life that I have is all that I have, and the life that I have is yours. The love that I have of the life that I have is yours and yours and yours. A sleep I shall have, a rest I shall have, yet death will be but a pause. For the peace of my ears and the long green grass will be yours and yours and yours. Thank you.
Thank you, Trish. Let us welcome the gospel. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Give thanks to the risen Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Give praise to his name. May the Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Seeing the crowds, Jesus went up the hill. He was joined by his disciples, and this is what he taught them. How happy are the poor in spirit. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Happy are the gentle. They will have the earth for their heritage. Happy are those who mourn and are sorrowful. They will be comforted. Happy those who hunger and thirst for what is right. They shall be satisfied. Happy are the merciful, for they will have mercy shown to them. Happy the pure in heart, they shall see God. Happy are the peacemakers, they will be called sons and daughters of God. Happy those who are persecuted in the cause of right. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The Gospel of the Lord. At the beginning of our Mass, in the family names I omitted, her cousin Rowan Donoghue here, and Rowan and I were classmates at Green Meadows Seminary from the 11th of February 1974. I mean, time flies when you're having fun, and he has been a much loved and respected friend of our family, and that's how I got to know the Donoghue and the Clark family, so we go back a long, long way. Rowan sang at my ordination, which was 38 years ago yesterday. So, welcome Rowan. And I also omitted the parishioners who have been so good to Sandy and to John, to Mark and the family. They have been wonderful in supporting the family. And finally, the staff at Winara Home and Hospital. They were outstanding. I went to anoint Sandy for the last time on last Saturday afternoon. And the nurses, and I said this in my homily, they were about to turn her and wash her. And the charge nurse stepped back and she said, Your coming, your blessing is far more important. We can wait. And so they stood there. One of the nurses came in and prayed with me, as they liked to do, and I liked them to do. Sandy opened her eyes and sort of looked. I was thinking during the slideshow, she had a very knowing look. She was incredibly wise, and she certainly knew more than her Hail Marys. But she was a good person, and I think the sacraments through the months that she was at Winara, people taking communion, myself at times too, they were very important to her. Although John, as John used to remind me, she hasn't got her hearing aids in, so we had to sometimes just mouth the words. So how do we honour her? You have memories that Mark has spoken about, and they have triggered your own memories. We have marching girls here from Dannebirk. June is one of them, and there are others. So there are clients like Trish, Satisfied. There are people who dined at her home, her and John's home more recently, and with Mark and the family. She was an amazing cook, and whenever you went there, just for a light lunch, I remember one day I went, last time I went to John and Sandy's, it was just a light lunch, and man, the table was groaning with food from one end to the other. So, you know, being a good Nainai person like some of the Clark family, I thought, well, I'll just try one of everything, you know, but then I went away with the shortbread. She was a great cook. I found this, I was thinking about hairdressers and in my prayer this morning, and thinking, you know, they have a very important role in our society. The Americans have a saying, get your hair done, you'll feel better. And I think Sandra and hairdressers are like confessors, really. You'll be very pleased, probably, that she's taken her secrets to the grave, I guess, but she would have listened to a lot of them. Here's a poem by Lynn Howard about hairdressers. What secrets are revealed whilst mirrored in that chair, all caped and gowned and waiting for the trusted hairdresser to share? As scissors work at a frenzy, feverishly between cuts and snips, she listens intently with friendly ear, empathy at her fingertips. Day after day, week after week, so many tales does she acquaint, remaining focused in the task at hand, but with the patience of a saint. It's a great summary of the gospel. It's a great summary of those qualities that Sandy had in spades: gentleness, forgiveness, justice, peacemaking. Sometimes love dies, sometimes we have to make choices, but always with Sandy, she made those choices with love and with forgiveness and with openness, and talked about, as Natalie has also the other day with me and Kathy, she said, you know, we were one happy family. And that's what happens when we have just one virtue such as forgiveness or peacemaking and take it into great depth, really deep in our hearts, so that it just seems like a natural thing to do. I think people of virtue like Sandy was, they don't think anything about what they do. And she would say, she was self-deprecating, well, it's just what you do. It's just how you live. But it's not how everybody lives. And so when we have a model of virtue, and this is not a canonization ceremony, she would hate me to do that, and that would dishonor her. But when we have a model of goodness, it stops us in our tracks. And we call the Beatitudes, from the Latin Beatus, qualities of the kingdom of God, or qualities of the reign of God. If you want to know what those shafts of sunlight, those moonbeams of grace look like, they're very simple, Jesus is saying. He's taking these human needs of belonging, of safety, of trust, of starting again, of healing, and he's saying, When we see these present, the reign of God is present. On Monday, we gather to for the funeral of her other cousin, Glenys Clark, whom I knew well as a baby priest, ordained in 83, but my first appointment was to Wellington Hospital. And Glenys Clark, Sandy's cousin and Rowan's cousin, was the charge nurse of the orthopaedic ward. She was a formidable nurse and a formidable ward sister, but she had buckets of compassion, a sense of humour, and a wonderful sense of hospitality. So when Mark was talking about the generation that they came from, it reminded me that there must be something in your family tree that there's a strong river of grace. And I always felt home in that river of grace with the Clark family. So may Sandy and Glenys and all the loved ones who have gone before us and encouraged us to be good people and to grow in love, may they truly rest in peace. We've chosen two of her former clients, Bob and Carol, to bring up our offertory gifts of bread and wine, and we're going to listen to We'll Meet Again during that time.
We'll meet again. Don't know when, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you always do.
So we pray that our bread, our wine, and our prayers for Sandy may be acceptable to God, our loving Father. Amen. Loving God, it is our certain faith that your Son Jesus, who died upon the cross, is risen from the dead, and is the first fruits of all who have fallen asleep. Grant through this mystery of faith, our sister Sandy, who has gone to her rest in Christ, may now share in the fullness of the joy of the resurrection through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord Holy Father, Almighty and eternal God, through Jesus. He is the salvation of the world, the life of the human race, the resurrection of the dead. With the saints and angels, we join in their unending hymn of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, Lord, the fountain of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He gave the bread to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, Jesus took the chalice, and once again he gave thanks. He gave the cup to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life, the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, John and Paul, our bishops, and all the ministers of your gospel. Remember Sandy Dalziel, whom you have called home to yourself. Grant that she, who was united with your son in a death like his, may be one with him in his resurrection. Have mercy on us all, we pray, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, Saint Joseph, the apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, that we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Let us stand and pray together the prayer that Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Sister Barbara, could you help with communion, please, and bring the support? Please be seated. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. O te tinana o he hukaraiti, this is Jesus, the Lamb of God. We are blessed to be called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy to be shed out to my room, but I may say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
You're all very welcome to receive Holy Communion. You're also very welcome to come and ask for a blessing. If you need assistance, could you indicate and we will bring you communion first.
Oh,
Just before the final and commendation prayers, may I thank you on behalf of all the family for your love and prayers here today. The cremation is private, but you're welcome to go to the Waikanae Funeral Home, the Cedarwood Funeral Home in Parata Street in Waikanae, and the family will meet you very soon after that, would like to meet with you and share light refreshments before you travel home. Thank you, everyone. Let us pray, and please stand. Before we go our separate ways, we take leave of our sister Sandy. May our farewell continue to express our love and respect for her. May it help to ease our sadness and strengthen our own faith and hope. One day we shall joyfully greet her again when the love of Jesus, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. In baptism, we are reminded that all of us carry the Holy Spirit in our hearts, the Wairua Tapu. As a sign of respect and reverence, we bless the casket and then incense the casket. Our response, receive her soul and present her to God the Most High. Saints of God, come to her aid, hasten to meet her, angels of the Lord. May Christ, who called you Sandy, take you home to himself. May the angels lead you to the side of Sarah and Abraham. Eternal rest give to her, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon her. Into your hands, God of mercies, we commend Sandy, in the sure and certain hope that she will live with Christ forever. We give you thanks for all the blessings you gave her in her life, and the blessings you gave her family, her loved ones, and our community through her life. They are signs to us of your goodness, of the presence of the kingdom and grace, and of our friendship with all the saints in Christ. Sandy, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. May the choirs of angels welcome you home, and where Lazarus is poor no longer at the city gates, may you truly find eternal rest. Amen.